God bless you. Thank you for joining me. This is Bishop Dr. Gabriel McCurtis. I'm so glad that you were able to join me today. The debut of my book entitled Coming From Behind, The Mindset of an Overcomer by yours truly. Well, I just finished all the arduous work of, first I wrote the book and been editing the book, and finally we got everything done, and it will be out within the next few weeks, starting off on Amazon and then working after that to get it on the bookstores. Love to see this book, number one bestseller on Amazon, number one bestseller on other things like New York Times and different things. That would be my heart's desire. Let's talk a little bit about the book. Talk a little bit about myself. Most of you that are watching know me. Some of you don't know me. Let me give you my story and the story behind the writing of this book. I was raised in Ventura. We moved out here in 1962 with my family, my father, Reverend Luther McCurtis, and my mother, Oratia McCurtis. They brought us out here from Arizona. I was 5 years old when we got here and started school, went to Sheridan Way Elementary School, De Anza Junior High School, Ventura High School. While at Ventura High School, I was a track and field runner, very gifted, but I was also not just an athlete. I was an athlete scholar. But there was one particular race that I ran that really impacted my life and set the trajectory of my life and my career to who I am today. As I said, Bishop Dr. Gabriel McCurtis. I have 2 earned doctorate degrees and many other things. Been a superintendent of schools. I'm a retired superintendent of schools, and now debuting as an author. Now, this is my debut solo book. I've written a chapter in another book with my debut solo book, which I'm so proud of. Done a lot of these things, but the principles that's governed my life came from this event. 1975, waiting for the Channel Island Track and Field Finals in Hueneme, California, I reflected back just a few weeks earlier till I got to the race. It had been raining, and we were not able to practice out on the track field. So my coach at that time, Coach Ralph Martinez, Coach Stanifer, and other, I believe Stanifer is the late Coach Stanifer, but I don't know if my other coaches are still alive or not, but they were there. But Coach Martinez had us come in. We had to start working out in the gym. Could no longer work out on the track and field. And I felt a little bit disappointed, but it was a good thing. During that time, which in the book I called during that hiatus, I had to do some soul searching. Although I went undefeated in the season through my preseason track meets and my league track meets, I had some invitational meets that I did not fare very well in. Some of those that I was scheduled to win, I didn't, and I began to realize why. I tightened up and began to start not running my race, but running someone else's race, and ended up not taking first, sometimes second or third, and that bothered me. But during this hiatus, I had a chance to rest and think, begin to realize that I had to keep my eyes focused off other people's races, and focus totally on my race. Finally, the big day came, and I was there at Hueneme, and I went and warmed up. And at that time, my wife, Deborah, was my girlfriend. She's been my wife now. We've been married 45 years, but she was my girlfriend. We were 18 years old, and we had been dating for about 2 or 3 years, even at that time. And it was time for the high hurdles, and I had promised her 2 medals. I was running the 120 highs and the 330 low hurdles during that time. And I said, I'm going to bring you back 2 medals, knowing that the same time last year, I told her I was going to bring her back 2 medals, and I was the favorite winner. but I had some mechanical errors in a couple of races, and I lost. I was taken first, I took second in both races the year before. I was very cognizant of the fact that that was that could happen. So, got in the race, very prepared. The gun went off. Like always, I believe first one out of the blocks, first one over the hurdles was going to win. Boom, the gun sounded. Boom, I hit that first hurdle, and as I was going over the first hurdle, I felt a sharp pain in my right leg, which was my trail leg. The runner to my right spiked me, and it caught me. And when you're running so fast, a very ballistic race, ballistic. If you fire a gun, boom, that bullet is ballistic. When you're running anything that's exceptionally fast, we call that ballistic. I was running so fast that I couldn't think about it. Just in my mind, I felt that little cold thing go through my leg, and I said, something's wrong. But I said, never mind, and I kept running, hit the second hurdle. Same piercing feeling that I went through my leg, and I realized I'd been spiked two times by the hurdler to my left. Now, I was a good hurdler. He wasn't. The one that was to my right, I'm saying, was not a very good hurdler, and he interfered with me. And whereas I was in the first place, by me being spiked, it staggered me. And while it staggered me, the group of runners went by, and I sat there having to get back in the race. To my right-hand side as I was running, I could see the stands, the Wainimi High School stands, and my wife was there. And it looked like I can touch her, my wife at that time, girlfriend Deborah. She was there along with her friends, and I said, oh man, I don't want to be embarrassed. And so I said, this was internal dialogue with me. I got to get out of this mess. Well, while I was getting out of this mess, the race was just gone, passing by. So finally, I got to the third hurdle, broke away from the offender next to me. And I decided, instead of quitting, I could have quit, I could have yelled foul and all that, and because of the cuts on my leg and the things that were going on, I know the referee, my coach would have also advocated for me. They would have had us start the race over and rerun the race because of interference, and the guy to my right probably would have been disqualified for interfering. But I had to make a split second decision. Do I quit, or do I continue running? And so the winner that I was inside, I said, I am going to run. So in running, I had to make up ground. This is the beginning that made up this book. Now I'm going to go through the 10 hurdles. I'm not going to read my book, but each hurdle represented a principle. And I know I got you intrigued on the race. What happened after that, Gabriel? What happened? I'll tell you in a minute. When I finished my all of my studies, working on my second doctorate just a year ago, I went to the Southeastern University in Florida, and I worked on my second doctorate, which was a DSL, or a Doctorate of Strategic Leadership. And I was working on my doctorate, and I said I wanted to write a book. Now, in the program that I was in, it was a PhD DSL. It was the same track. And in this same track, all the coursework was the same all the way until we got up into our comps. Your comps is at the end of 3 years, all the learning that we did, you had to take a test. Once you took that test and passed it, PhD went to the left, and they went more into research. And because I already had an earned doctorate degree, I didn't want to write another dissertation. I'd already done that. So I said, I'm not going the PhD route. I'm not going to be a university professor. I wanted to go the DSL route, more the practical route. I want a practitioner. I want to be more of a consultant, a coach. So I went to the right. They went to the left. It was only a semester or so where we differed. And so in my the way that I went in DSL allowed me to demonstrate my learning, and I said, I want to write a book. The PhD people went to the left, they did something else. I wanted to write a book. I wanted to write a good book. We were the first cohort at Southeastern University in Lakeland, Florida, and I wanted to set the standard high for the DSL students. And so, in doing so, we were in class, and my professor, Dr. Hansen, was talking, we were talking to in our class, and he was telling everybody, I want you to tell me what you're gonna write, what's the name of your book? And so he came to me, Gabriel. I said, yes. What are you gonna write about? And I said, well, you know, I ran this race back in high school. I ran the hurdles. This is what happened. And it was Dr. Hansen said, it's a hurdle race? Yes. He said, 10 hurdles? Yes. He said, there's 10 chapters right there. Each chapter will talk about what happened in this hurdle race. And thank you, Dr. Hansen. I know you're listening by now. Very much so instrumental in encouraging me to do so. And so I decided to write the book. Remember, coming from behind, the mindset of overcoming adversity. So, in thinking about the book and outlining it and all the things that I had to deal with in this race, and I'm still dealing with the race, these are the things that I learn as I take you to the race. Number one, lessons learned from life's hurdles, coming from my book. Number one hurdle. Inadequate preparation. Avoid entering your competition unprepared to compete at your best mentally, physically, and emotionally. Well, I was ready to compete. So if you come in not ready to compete, don't think you're going to win. I was ready to compete. So I did come in prepared. But you're going to find out when you're running a hurdle race, when you're running life in life, there are setbacks despite how well you are prepared. Think about that. Number two, hurdle number two, being unprepared to handle contingencies. Expect the unexpected and prepare yourself to overcome all unforeseen problems. I was spiked not only once, but twice. In my book, I said, lightning can strike twice. Sometimes bad things, terrible things can happen more than once. Bam! I didn't bring this upon myself. I'm prepared. I'm coming in as the top-rated athlete, and here I am struggling in last place. That doesn't make sense, but it's not supposed to make sense. Life doesn't make sense. Third hurdle, number three, resist arrogant pride. Arrogance and conceit will try to captivate your soul, but resist the temptation of all costs. So as I was going through my mind when I hit the third hurdle, excuse me, I saw my wife, I saw the athletes and all other people. Why did I want to win? Did I want to win because I was conceited and I wanted to brag? Or did I want to win for other reasons? Did I want to win because I wanted to set the standard high for posterity's sake? Did I want to win because I wanted to represent my school, my team? I was the team captain. What was the motivating factor behind me wanting to win? It shouldn't be arrogant pride. That was the third hurdle. Hurdle number four, the loss of faith and hope. Losing your faith and hope results in discouragement that will compel you to give up and quit, but do not give in to its influence. In other words, so by the time I'm getting to the fourth hurdle, can I still win? The group had passed me by. I'm trying to get back in the race. I'm dealing with all of these factors. Can I still win? The Bible said, when you talk about faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. I used to hear someone say, keep hope alive. I didn't understand that. But do you know hope is the foundation of faith? If you don't have hope, you don't have faith, you're not going to get a positive outcome. So I had to encourage myself, and you'll find that in chapter 4. I talked about how David, King David, when he was out and his property got destroyed, and he was in Ziklag, and the enemy came and got him and destroyed him, and his men were going to kill him. He had to encourage himself. So I had to bring up hope. Hope had to come up within me. I can still do this. Hung in there. Got to the fifth hurdle. Hurdle five, the testing of your leadership ability. Here's what I said. Without a doubt, your leadership ability will be tested. to clear a hurdle necessary to become an inspirational and impactful leader, you must develop your leadership acumen and purpose to help those you lead become their best selves. So my leadership, I was the team captain. I was the MVP. At least the year before, I was the MVP, and as I went, a few weeks later, I was also the MVP again. But I was the MVP. My leadership was being tested. It was being assaulted. Was I a leader, or was I just a poop butt? I'm glad I proved that I wasn't a poop butt, because they'd be calling me a poop butt today, and if I had a loss. Hurdle number six: your lead will be challenged. Failing to remain focused after losing your lead in a competition can compromise your ability to regain the lead. In other words, my lead was already challenged in the race, but I'm getting ready to challenge someone else's lead. I said, I'm not going out like this. And so with me coming from behind new, I have to get back in the game. And so I'm trying to say, when you're running, your lead is going to be challenged. Mine had already been compromised. I was getting it back. But I was getting ready to catch and snatch some fellas that were ahead of me. And so what I said, your lead will be challenged. Yeah, I challenged their lead. And I caught up with them and I dusted them in the end. But your lead will be challenged, number six. Number seven. Hurdle seven, reliance upon past successes to resolve new challenges. What I did last week before, even if I was the MVP last year, what did that have to do with the race that I was in? The Bible said forgetting those things which are behind, reaching for those things which are ahead. We have to press toward the mark, toward the prize of the high calling, which is in Christ Jesus. You have to forget even the good or the bad, you have to forget about some things. You can't move forward looking in the rear view mirror. I had to do that. In other words, whatever happened yesterday wasn't there. What's going on today? So it got me onto the eighth hurdle, overcoming the battle of life. You will face your battle of life, win it, and the world will swing wide open its doors. Lose it, and the world will shut you out of a lifetime of opportunities that were designed for you. Therefore, fight to win at all costs. Your future depends on it. So at this, when I'm up at the eighth hurdle. Now, I caught up with these guys, caught them about the seventh hurdle. I challenged them, re-challenged them, got my lead back, hit the eighth hurdle. And as I said, overcoming the battle of life. That was a battle. And I'll tell you about the battle of life when you read it in the book. My mother taught me about the battle of life when I was young. I was in elementary school. My brother Michael and I, love you, baby. Love you, older brother. I'm baby brother. He calls me Gabe the Blade, baby brother, and he's my older brother. But Mike and I knew a wino by the name of Tex. Tex was an alcoholic that he lived in Ventura. He was a hobo. Back in the days, a hobo would catch trains and just go from place to place. And Tex, although he was a hobo, just the nicest man in the world, and he would always, if he'd catch Michael and I, he'd buy us some penny candy. So he'd come out the corner liquor store. If Michael and I were walking up the street, he'd beckon us over, and we'd come over, and he'd have us walk in the liquor store and get some penny candies. Back then, penny candies, for a penny, you can get like three pieces of candy for a penny back in those days. So if he spent 3 cents on us, man, me and Michael walked out with a wad full of candy. And so, but Tex, he was a wino. And after we'd gotten our candy and stuff, one day I ran into my mom. I said, Mom, what's going on with Tex? She said, Tex lost the battle of life. I said, well, what is the battle of life? She told me, in your life, you are going to confront many obstacles. You're going to confront setbacks. You're going to have to fight to get what you want out of life. She said, if you win, life works for you. But if you lose, life works against you. She said, Tex lost, and life is working against him. I didn't fully understand what my mother said, but while I was in this race, And years later now, at 65 years old, I fully understand what my mother was telling me when I was only in elementary school. I had to win the battle of life. I was in the battle for this race. It was the battle of my life. This was ferocious competition. Hurdle number nine, losing your competitive edge. Your competitive edge is what makes you, what keeps you in the lead. Therefore, never be so generous that you loan, give away, or compromise your ability to remain out front as you compete in life. So, as I'm out front, I'm saying yes, I don't want to do anything that's going to mess with my race, inhibit my race. Let me tell you a story. It's in the book. You got to buy the book. These are all stories that I put together. Not only is this book about my life, it's a well-researched book too. I mean, I have nearly 100 authors that I've used in this book, references. So it's well researched. It's rich in content. But in this race, I remember in ninth grade, we didn't Inventor Unified, we didn't start high school until we got into 10th grade. So in ninth grade, we were still in, back then, called junior high school. So they didn't have competitive sports in junior high school. So if I played football, either Pop Warner or Boys Club and different things, and I played with other people coming up, Bobby Caron, Ralph Wilson, David Williams, Mike Fry. Man, if some of my friends say, Gabe, you missed my name. Why didn't you miss my name? Eric Mayer. Mayer and I, we were like that. But I started off in Pop Warner. Many of my friends, Bobby and them, they started off much earlier than me. But I started football in ninth grade. But that year, not only did I play football, I ran track for the Ventura Boys Club. And so they took a group of ragtag runners, and I was one of the ragtag runners. Always was fast all my life. I'm fast now. I may be 65, but don't come up against me. I'll run you down. So we get up to Santa Barbara, and I was in the long jump. I had a pair of old tennis shoes. Back in those days, we had PF Flyers, old pair of PF Flyers. But to run track, you needed shoes with spikes on them, and I didn't have them. So we were doing the long jump, and I made it to the finals, but I had only made it to the finals like in second place because I didn't have the right running apparel, the shoes and stuff. And so I had a friend, I'm going to call him E. If I call his name and he's looking at this, I don't want him to get mad at me, but it's true. He was running for Santa Maria Boys Club, and we get down there, and so it was my final jump. I was in second place, and so I said, E, yeah, okay. I said, let me borrow your spikes. He said, okay. So I borrowed his spikes and went out there and hit that track. The spikes was gripping that little tartan. Now the track wasn't tartan, it was just the tartan on the runway up to the long jump pit. I'm just spiking and grabbing. Hit that pit, bow! 19 feet something in ninth grade. McCurtis, first place. I still got the gold medal, Boys Club of America medal. I have it somewhere off in where all of my medals are. Took first, beat E, and E was a better long jumper than me, but he gave me his shoes. I just told you, he lost his competitive edge, loaned his shoes to a competitor that beat him at a game that he should win. Thanks, E. You know who you are. I appreciate it. But this was a lesson I learned. Never loan your shoes. I walked off with the medal. Lee E walked off with the embarrassment of his team, mad at him because it cost him first place in there. Don't lose your competitive edge. That was hurdle number 9. Hurdle number 10. Don't celebrate too early. The race is not over until you cross the finish line. You may be tempted to celebrate victory prematurely, but do not yield. Otherwise, you may be shocked at a competitor as a competitor blows by you at the last second. Focus on finishing before you start partying. And so what I wrote in this, although I was at the 10th hurdle, even when you're running, I'm at the 10th hurdle, I'm still cognizant there's people behind me. Now, I had these guys beat, but in my mind I said, I'm not settling, I'm not compromising, I'm not slowing down. My coach taught us always to sprint past the finish line. I said, I'm sprinting, and so when I hit that last hurdle, I came over that last hurdle, man, I was running like my life depended on it. Went in there, bam, And I was just, people were calling off times. All of a sudden, bam, I went in there. Didn't realize I set a school record. I set a meet record. I didn't realize all this stuff. But once the other people came in a few seconds after me, I found out I ran a 14.5. I never run a 14.5. When I came into that race, I'd run a 14.8. 14.5 was the fastest that I ran during the year. The Ventura High School school record was 14.6. I broke it. My record is broken today. Records are made to be broken. But that record that stood for all of those years was broken by Gabriel Eugene McCurtis, 18 years old. I came in. Don't celebrate too early. Some people are throwing up the peace sign and the number one sign as they get over the last hurdle, or they're the only to get snatched by someone behind them. So these are the principles that I'm teaching, coming from behind, the mindset of overcoming adversity. If you buy the book, when you buy the book, you'll enjoy the reading that I have in there, the growth of things. I've broken up the book. The book is broken up into sections, and I'll let you know what the sections are. Not only do you have the content, let me go to my, I'm going to go here to the table of contents. So, chapters, how to effectively deal with interference, the response, chapter 2, the pride of achievement, not arrogance, you can do it. Each chapter, as I talk about, is different hurdles. But, so, I have the content. When we finish, I always have, in the book, I'll just show you real quick so you can see where I'm coming from. I always have a trainer's tip. So here's my trainer's tip number one. There are times when you will not meet your expectations. Do not be alarmed, as this is part of life. So throughout the book, it's rich in trainer's tips. And then as I make it towards, then I've given you the hurdling tips. You'll find that out in the book at the beginning of each chapter. Now, at the end of each chapter, I have what we call the mindset of the overcomer. And let me read that to you. The mindset of an overcomer. Overcomers prevail and conquer their obstacles and hurdles despite setbacks by maintaining a never give up and never give in mentality. This rich is rich in the mindsets and the training tips and different things. And then the chapters end, I always end with reflective questions, provocative questions. This is for you to read, apply the content. When I ask you questions, how does that apply to your life? It gives you homework to do and other things. Powerful book for someone for someone's first solo book. I think I've done a great job. Thank you, Dr. Hansen, for all that you did, for helping me to tweak and think and adjust. Thank you, Southeastern doctoral team, Jenny, Dr. Jenny, as you led our team, and Dr. Hawkins, and man, I know I'm forgetting many of my doctors' names as I'm here. All you guys, the inculcation that I was able to get from you as you spewed out extensive pedagogy that I was able to imbibe. I'm talking all that stuff that I learned in school. I don't talk like that. Basically, thank you for helping the brother out. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, but this book is coming out in a few weeks. It's going to print. Once it's in the print, as I said, it will come out on Amazon. I will have in the bottom, some of you might say, I want a copy now. Gabe, I want you to sign it. If you want me to sign it, I'm going to put a link in. When you pay your money, when the book comes out, I'll sign it and I'll send it in to you. But this is a book, and the reason I'm glad that I'm writing, that I've written this book, look at where our country is now. Look at where we are in America. Right now, we're ready to go into an election. It's the weekend right before. This is November 6th. November 8th is just a couple of days away. Who knows where our country's going? People, we've dealt with COVID. People have lost jobs. People have lost loved ones. You're talking about setbacks? People have experienced setbacks. But this book says a setback is just a setup for something great that God has for you in your life. Yes, I know that you've been through things. I've been through things. Yes, I know that there's hurdles. Yes, I know that lightning has struck twice in your life, sometimes three times. But do you know there's life after setback? Now, I'm a preacher. Like, that's why I'm Bishop McCurdy. I'm a preacher. And boy, I could have capitalized on that. That's as an African American Church of God in Christ preacher. That's when you want a hoopie. Yeah. But I'm not saying yeah to you. I'm going to just draw this back for a minute. And I'm coming in to close. Speaking of setbacks, I just a few weeks ago finished my third series of back surgeries. Over 5 years, I've been under the knife three times. First year, 10 hours. Second time, 12 hours. This last time, 7 hours. And I went from bad to worse to worser to worsest, which is not even, I'm just being facetious for you. But things were not working out. And I had to live through this. I've been limping and hobbling and not being able to sit down and stuff, and look like I was just, it's like I'm consigned to a life of pain and a life of medication. And someone that was active like me, sprinted all the way till I was 60, could whip anybody. And now, the last 5 years, I couldn't even go to my university graduation. I graduated, as I said, with a second doctorate. I got my doctorate, but I couldn't graduate with it. But I had this last surgery a few weeks ago. And when my surgeon came in, Gabe, how you doing? And I noticed there was something different about this last surgery. Before he walked in the door, the people from physical therapy came in. I noticed I jumped up out of bed. This is just a day or two after surgery. They said, we're going to take you for a walk. I grabbed my little walker. I said, let's go, man. I just spurted out and I was doing all kind of stuff. Well, I thought I was going to be able to leave that night. Well, the next day, I had a setback. I was overly medicated. The next day, you would have thought everything that happened in the surgery just was taken back. But they found out I was just overly medicated, and I'm not going to name the hospital or nothing, but I was overly medicated, which was a setback for me. But after I got through that day, I got back to normal. I really realized this surgery works. Do you know, this morning before I did this, and I'm still recuperating, I'm only about three and a half weeks from my surgery. You know, I walked nearly 2 miles this morning. Do you know I can stand up and sit down better? I'm still recuperating. But look at three surgeries. What a setback for an active person. 65 years old. Now it looks like I'm getting my mobility back. I'm getting my life back. New book coming out. New doctorate hanging on the wall. New opportunities. My mentor, my friend, love him to death, Bishop Charles E. Blake, he says, I see you in the future. He says that all the time, I see you in the future. And he says, you look much better than you look now. And I say, I see you in the future, and your future looks brighter. I sort of just gave a twist on what he said. But we can have a brighter future if we don't allow setbacks to stop us. So I want to encourage you, purchase the book. I want to encourage you, get back in the game. I want to encourage you, there's life after loss. I want to encourage you that COVID doesn't last always. God made you a winner. God made you an overcomer. Defeat does not come from God. You are the one that determines whether you're going to win or not. Now, God can say in his book, he's a winner, but so a man thinketh in his heart, what he thinks in his mind, so is he. Are you a winner? If you're having problems, get the book. If you're out front, get the book. Stay in front. If you're not out front, get the book. Get back in the race. This book, it will help you no matter whether you're a doctor, a lawyer, whether you're like Tex and you're on Skid Row. It's for all groups of people. Thank you so much for listening to me. Thank you so much for joining in. I see you in the future. and your future looks much better.